It ain't no game, but they saying welcome to the second level.
What's up, guys? Welcome back to episode 3 of the official Level 2 podcast. Today, you can see we have a third person. We have a special guest here. I'm Keegan, you got Tom, and you got Cody from the Dream Saga. I like how you mouth that with me. How you doing, Cody?
I'm doing great. How are you guys doing?
I'm doing pretty good. It's a little wet and rainy today, so there's that.
Yeah,
I'm excited. It's the perfect weather for some voting.
It is. It's actually election day today.
It is, yeah.
So when we're recording this, I was going to say April 8th. Wow, November 8th. Yeah. I'm out of it right now. Don't worry about me.
Keegan's on a lot of drugs for things. Not like recreationally.
No.
Well, maybe. But maybe. Mostly not recreationally.
Yes.
So he's going to be a little kooky for the entirety of this podcast. Enjoy.
So with that being said, let's start off like we normally do. We'll start with you since you're our guest.
Oh,
you know, that's crazy. What are you up to? What have you been doing the last week or so? Playing
what
games?
What are you up to? I'm your podcast, Keegan. What do you mean?
I'm recording a podcast with you.
Keegan, all I've done is just watch all your videos.
Aww. At level2gamers.com.
Level2gamers.com.
Shameless plug. Listen to us on Level 2 Gaming Podcast on iTunes and Google Play.
He's a polite liar.
He's a polite liar, yes. I've been playing a lot of Fallout 4.
Still? Do you have the DLC?
Yes, I have the DLC.
All the DLCs? Or?
I haven't gotten the latest one.
Okay, because Contraptions looks real cool. That's the one like, I'm excited about.
Like, Nuka World I have not gotten.
That actually looks pretty cool.
But it is... Well, and the thing is, I don't ever go through the main story that much.
Mm-hmm.
I literally just explore. Like, I just find the little things in that world and just kind of go for it. So
that's one of the nice things about those games is that you don't have to pay any attention to
the story. I think I made it to where I figured out enough that was going on,
mm-hmm.
but I didn't get to the point where I actually
you just got bored.
I played for like 20 something hours.
I got pretty far in the story with that, and then I just kind of, I don't know what it was. Like, I think something else came out. I think it was I don't know what it was, but something came out.
I got bored of building buildings, essentially, is what happened.
Well, you played it like Minecraft.
Yeah,
that's the best part for that.
You like that?
Because I like scavenging and I like taking it all back.
What do you think of Contraptions then? Because that's added on.
I have yet to even play that side.
Because it looks a lot of fun.
I have Sanctuary Hills is the main base for my main character,
mm-hmm.
and I built my base up a ladder. And so if people start showing up, I just delete the ladder or delete the stairs and they can't get to my people. So everyone goes up top and there's just like a bunch of defenses and
how
stuff.
How cool would it be to have like an MMO Fallout 4, like PvP, like base building stuff? Oh, or even if it's not Fallout 4, even if it's just a base building game.
I mean, they've proven they can do it with Elder Scrolls Online. Yeah. Just tweak the... I mean, essentially, Elder Scrolls and Fallout are the same
game. Same thing. It's just different skins on them.
So yeah, absolutely.
Yep, I would kill you immediately.
Yeah, probably.
That's most people's reaction.
So let's also you do the Dream Saga. You're doing daily vlogs. You started that recently, and
I like those.
Do food videos.
I do unboxings. Candy Tuesdays and Unbox Fridays.
Yes.
Candy Tuesday just started up. A lot of the candy that I ordered online is starting to show up.
These are candies from other countries, not necessarily American candies.
Right.
Which is where we live, by the way.
Yeah. So we have my good friend Tora, which you guys know
from work.
He speaks and reads Japanese, and so a lot of the Japanese candies and stuff we're doing, he's actually going to be adding Japanese subtitles.
That's awesome.
So that way, you know, when they broadcast over there, they can, you know, actually understand our reactions to
candies. So how does typing Japanese on a keyboard work? I've never actually tried to type, because I can do, like, the accents for, like, French, but... Is it a software thing that he's doing then when he types it? How does that work?
I assume he's doing everything, I think, mainly through his phone.
Oh.
And so he...
Just does a Japanese keyboard?
Yep. And just
I think the Japanese keyboard allows you to write in kanji and things like that.
See, I'm thinking on like a computer that has a normal setup. Like
you can also put a skin over a keyboard.
Yeah, that's true.
Yep.
Because they're all the same layout. But.
Yeah. Yeah, it's just like if you were to order a computer with a Japanese keyboard, you can then also just... Because thankfully, I think there's only a couple versions, at least of like MacBooks, that have a different keyboard layout for certain things like that. So typically it's just a universal like skin, like Tom was saying, that you can just pop down and click on it. Because there's a lot of people that I know that buy stickers that have both languages on them, so they know exactly what they're typing.
Because I now have a separate keyboard for it, but I used to put like a film over top of it, told me there's keyboard shortcuts, so it's similar. I guess similar concept.
It was colorful. I remember that keyboard.
Yeah, I still have it. I might pull it out at some point. and show you.
Settle down.
But so vlogs every day.
Yep,
and
vlogs every
Tuesdays
day.
And Fridays are your.
And the vlogs are not just you either. They're you and your lovely
my
lady friend.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. She's gracefully accepted the existence of YouTube, and just goes along with it.
The real question is her idea or your idea? Like, did you have to begrudgingly be like, we're gonna do this, or she's like, yeah, let's do this?
So many moons ago, before the Dream Saga, we actually did vlogs.
Mm-hmm.
And she was always stoked about it. I think I have on my old channel that I don't really use anymore, just there for archives.
Posterity.
It was like maybe 5 or 6 years ago I started the vlogs on her birthday. So I have those like, hey, this, you know, we went out mm-hmm. to the birthday and this is, you know, our way of spending time with our family who are nowhere near us.
Mm-hmm.
So like her mom, grandparents, my dad, all
it's
can
like a video email.
Yeah, they can right. kind of see what's
doing.
Going on.
Yeah. Yeah, so it's kind of our little day to day. They can kind of see what's going on. I can share my life with other people.
Do you feel pressure to do cool things every day then? Because that's the part with daily vlogging. I've tried. And I'm like, I don't have a cool enough life. I sit on my butt and edit videos.
Yeah, and that's the thing. It's getting me out of my shell. You know, I don't like vlogging in public.
It's
but,
real weird.
But the more I do it, the easier things get. Where I just walked into PetSmart mm-hmm. the other day, and people were staring at me. I'm just like, nah, whatever. Yeah. It's like people walking in their cars or something like that, or walking through a mall. It's people are going to stare. Yeah. But the thing is, we've gotten so used to watching people FaceTime, and so no one really looks anymore.
Yeah.
Right.
Or cares.
Well, even when I went to Wizard World and did the vlog for that, like, you're at a convention, and people know you're getting footage and all that kind of stuff, but it's still weird walking around and having that... You know people are looking at you because yeah. you're staring at your phone. Even
I see people doing it more and more, though. Like around the mall and stuff like that, even where we work, you know, I see ladies with their phones out, and they're, like, talking away. And it's not FaceTime. They're yeah. actually, like, they're either Facebook Live or whatever.
Yeah.
And we were in...
it's just weird.
We were in Del Mar the other day, me and my wife. We were in an art place, art store in mm-hmm. there. And there was a lady walking around doing Facebook Live with all the, like, sculptures and stuff in store.
I got a notification he went live
weird.
Today at some point.
Yep.
And my phone was like, Cody's live. I was like, hey, Cody.
Yeah, we were...
and it's not by because I was hanging with Grandma, but...
Yeah, we were waiting in the parking lot of CVS waiting for, like, medication to go up. And so I was just, like, live, put my phone on my dash, and as it was raining. So I was like, we're not going to make any noise. We're just going to let that roll and do something artsy.
Artsy farty.
So you tried to make a small indie film in
yeah.
the CVS parking lot.
In the CVS parking lot.
With just, we'll just turn it live.
Solitary and, leaf flicking around in the wind.
Yeah, it was just lots of rain drips. It was really nice.
There you go. What about you, Tom? What have you been up to this past week?
Well, I got sick before you guys came over because I'm an idiot.
You played a VR game.
I did. I played a VR game.
Did you physically get sick or did you just nauseous?
No, very close to it. I had to take the helmet off. It was like, if I don't take it off, I'm going to blow chunks right
Which
now.
Which I've done once
already. Yeah. It, so I'm still playing XCOM 2. I can't stop playing it. Mm-hmm. It's so fucking hard. And so I still play that religiously. But then I got in the mail today Robinson Journey.
Which is basically Jurassic Park in VR.
I wouldn't go so far as to say story-wise it's like
but
it is dinosaurs in VR.
If you're
yes.
thinking of like what it is to somebody who doesn't know...
Yeah, I feel it's like kind of like a sci-fi version of Jurassic Park. And it is pretty, like the environments are great and everything, but the handling of the controls has been done awfully. The
control schemes are bad.
So, yeah. So, as far as like your usual options of like strafing and turning and things like that, the strafing is horribly slow. Even walking is painfully slow, and the turning is painfully fast. So you have this kind of like you're not
jerky.
Quite there, yeah. So it's not quite balanced tight enough for it to feel like a comfortable thing.
Is it something that you think they could fix in a patch, though?
I would hope so, because otherwise I'm not going to be able to play it. Because I was playing for maybe like. Jesus, 20 minutes, half mm-hmm. an hour, it's as far as I could take it, and then mm-hmm. I had to turn it off. And that upset me, because I've been looking forward to that one, and it's kind of one of the, not first, but one of the newer sort of touted AAA-style
like a quote-unquote full game.
Full length, yeah, for VR. And luckily, I picked it up pre-order from Amazon for $32, as opposed to what it's sort of retailing at in the PSN store, which was $60. So, yeah.
Amazon had he texted me that day, he's like, Amazon got a typo, you might want to order this.
And yeah,
like,
they fucked it up, I think. I'm pretty sure they fucked it up. They've done that before, apparently, so I keep an eye on Amazon now, because they're bad at selling.
If I pre-order, that's where I buy it from, just because I have Prime and you get the discount. around, so it makes sense.
Yeah,
I'm getting digital. And then...
But it was, it sucked. Because I was looking forward to that, and I've had a great time with VR lately. It's the first, I will say, bad experience with VR that I've had, and it was just before this podcast, so it makes me a little sad. Yeah. And also, it is, as we mentioned earlier, election day today, and I can't vote
because
I'm not American.
Not from America.
So that makes me a little sad.
Wait, too. You're not from America?
What? Not American?
I'm in America.
He's in America.
Not from America.
Yeah, he's from the company.
Well, my country didn't even get to choose their prime minister, so it is what it is. Yeah. I'm not too mad about it, but me and my wife have decided that tonight, once our podcast is over, she gets home, we're going to go for a meal, which we're going to consider to be our last meal on Earth, and then we're going to sit and watch the world burn.
Cool.
With CNN on TV. So.
Yay.
Can't wait to watch the season finale of America.
Yeah. Exactly. So that's it. TV wise, anything like that? Pretty much most of the same stuff I've been doing. We just finished The Night Of, that one we talked about last week.
Mm-hmm.
Great.
The weird
recommend
one.
It. You should watch it. Yeah, very, very good. And we've been trying to find a new show. We tried Dead of Summer. It was terrible. Don't recommend it.
don't watch it.
And that's where I'm at.
That's it. So yep. For me, I've been doing, so as I said at the end of the last podcast, my grandma had an accident and is in the hospital. She's not in the hospital.
She's doing
anymore.
Better, right?
Yeah, she's actually leaving rehab tomorrow. She signed the papers today to leave tomorrow. This is the only thing we're recording today because I had to go see her this morning. My dad came in this morning, hanging out with him, which is kind of cool. He flew from New Zealand to New York, New York to St. Louis. He skipped going to Japan and South Africa to come see her, which is kind of cool.
His dad's kind of a big deal.
My dad's not a big deal.
He's a big deal.
No, he just travels all.
They roll out the red carpet.
They do. He has over 300,000 freaking flyer miles.
Really?
Right now. Yeah.
Jesus.
You need 100,000 to be like the executive platinum whatever. That's in 12 months. By the way,
does he want to buy me a plane ticket somewhere?
Well, I told you he talked about buying me a plane ticket to Florida for Thanksgiving, like just to fly down to on Thanksgiving Day. And I was like, I appreciate it, but
it's a lot of work for one day.
Yeah, I'm gonna go hang out.
I would be pissed if I had to fly anywhere for one day.
Yeah, I'm gonna hang out with grandma instead. So we're going to have Thanksgiving together.
Especially if your flight is longer than a day to get there.
Yeah, I would maybe fly to Chicago for a day. Because Chicago from us is like, by the time you stopped your ascent, you're descending. But I couldn't.
Yeah.
Did you hear my chair?
Yeah. It's like, what was that, Tom?
My chair broke. Because A, I'm fat. And B, I'm really uncomfortable. But I just noticed before we started recording that my chair's broke. I'll share a picture on Instagram.
Yeah.
Here's the link to Instagram right here.
Yeah. So the other thing, gaming wise, what I've been doing is The Division had the big patch update 1.4. I think
you're big into that right now.
I'm big into that. I played yesterday with Tigrado, who it's been a while since I played with him.
Tigrado, the patron that gave us our question on last week's podcast.
Yes. So I played with him on there. Him and David both were like, this is stupid because they changed a lot of my gear sets. Like they were mad at first, but then they realized how much better it's gotten. So you're like, cool. Have you played? Because I know you played. You played with me.
Yeah, we played the other night.
With Ian.
Yep, that was, like, I hadn't really played a whole lot, and I wasn't really into it. Not as much as, like, you and Ian and those guys were.
Me and Ian are just, that's our game.
When I jumped in, like, my gear level, all that dropped, and I was like, nah. And then by the, like, a couple hours into it, everything was maxed out, and I was like, cool, this is way better. Yeah. I immediately liked
this.
Did
you see the rumor that the survival update's coming out next? So basically, when this podcast's going up, the rumor's when the survival's going to come out.
Really?
So they're going to raise your gear score to 256, which means there's new gear sets and stuff like that, which is cool, but it also means I'm grinding right now until those come out and get higher gear scores.
I don't think I can get back into it. Yeah. I liked it for a while. I had a lot of fun, especially with you guys playing. It was a lot of fun with friends. But I am not a social gamer as much as you are, as you know. So for me, the single player experience is always more fun.
Doesn't do single player
really
well.
A single player in there. Yeah, it's kind of so.
You could do like the main story, but once you hit end game, like I feel like you need friends.
I mean, as far as how the multiplayer works, I would much prefer a multiplayer game in the style of The Division than to, let's say, like Call of Duty or something, where it's just like match based. I prefer the open world nature to it and being able to go to like a PvP area. Same with Elder Scrolls.
Yeah,
but it just doesn't help my interest.
And then TV wise for me, I've been watching The Loud House, which is actually I texted you. I was like, hey, do you have the Loud House? You're like, no. I was like, dang it. Found it. I was watching it on iTunes. For those of you who don't know, I'm a big cartoon fan, and Nickelodeon cartoons back in the day, Rocket Power, Rocko's Modern Life, all those were my jam. So now, like, Loud House is kind of that together. The way it came about, and I'm debating on whether I want to do a review on it, but basically it won a shorts competition, and they signed it on to be part of Nickelodeon's, like, they had a shorts thing during the summer 2 years ago, and then they signed it on for one full season, so 13 episodes. Now it's up to, I think, 26 episodes confirmed, and it is really well done. The story is, there's this one little kid that lives with his 10 sisters, and their last name's Loud, thus the Loud House, and kind of the life that he has to live with having all sisters, whether it's them being super, like, gentled with him, like, oh, you scratched your face, oh, I'm sorry. Or, like, the last episode I watched was him talking about hanging out with a girl, and they're all like, ooh.
It sounds like one of those weird animes.
It kind of is, but it's a westernized cartoon. I don't like
the story, animes. The plot line sounds very anime.
Well, it's different yeah. each episode, but yeah.
Right.
I just love... The art style is a traditional art style where everything is just a single line. It's not cel-shaded, not... sort of like digital,
like the new Starbucks cup. You've seen that?
No.
The Christmas cup for Starbucks has a single line. Holiday cup.
Holiday.
Sorry.
No, it's not even the holiday cup. No. It's
pre-holiday cup.
Yeah, they released the cup. They released a green cup to show that everybody was interconnected and it was one.
And someone already found, like, one dude that's, like, not connected to the rest of it. Yeah, so they're like, you're liars, Starbucks.
There was a Starbucks employee that leaked the actual holiday cup, which is a red cup with, like, silver trees and
Satan.
It's called Satan's Bunghole.
Yeah. Whoa. But yeah, I've been watching Loud House. I thoroughly enjoy it. A lot of fun. If you're into cartoons, I highly recommend it. If you're a man-child. We decided that I'm Mowgli. Like, I'm a man-child. Spit out your drink. I'm a man-child. We decided this the other day that you want.
I'm like, well aware.
Hang out with Blue.
I've known you long enough.
So, but yeah, that's what I've been watching.
Okay, cool.
And doing this week. So let's get into the topic of the show. Whatever the hell we're going to call it, Ask Level 2 Gamers.
I liked Bonus Round or whatever.
Bonus, what? We put out a poll and whatever. Yeah. Like,
Bonus Level. Bonus
Level. But basically what this is if you are a Patreon supporter, it'll be a nice little link that'll probably go whoop right about now. If you're a Patreon supporter, patreon.com/level2gamersstl, you can donate and or support us. If you do $5 or more, you have the opportunity to choose a topic of the show, a bonus level, if we end up calling it that.
I like it.
I do too.
I decree bonus level.
Bonus level. So bonus, you'll be able to choose the level. Bonus level topic. And this bonus level topic is brought to you by Mr. Blue Moon Gaming, who is also one of our mods.
Drew.
Drew. Yeah, it's funny because I don't ever call him Drew.
Drew and Blue rhyme, so for me it's like the same thing.
Well,
so.
Apparently I started the whole Blue thing. Like, I call him Blue just because I know him from online. And
right.
Now James calls him, like, James, I can go back and forth between James and Tigrado, but Blue is always Blue. Like, he's never Drew.
Drew or Blue?
No, he's Drew Blue. But anyways, the topic today, I'm waiting for my notes to load here because iPhones. Give me a second.
Unprofessional.
I know, right? Podcast topic. So the topic from Mr. Blue Moon Gaming, otherwise known as Blue, is, does 4K gaming matter? What does it bring to the table, and how long will it take to fully implement true 4K gaming?
That's a three-part question.
He is a PC gamer, so that's kind of he's one of those guys where graphics matters a lot to him. We've talked about where, for us, graphics aren't necessarily the biggest thing, but he is a graphics-driven. This is why he likes PC gaming, which is teach their own type thing. So, do you want to start, Mr. Guest?
Sure.
What's your take?
Do I think 4K is...
Does 4K gaming matter? Let's start with that.
It depends on the type of game.
Okay.
I truly think, like, you know, years back when you had, you know, this was a movie, not so much a game, but the Final Fantasy movies that were coming out, I think pushing those to a game-based thing, or back when the PS2 had fantastic cinematics, but, like, the gameplay was just kind of crummy. Mm-hmm.
The FMVs.
Yeah.
People would get, like, Final Fantasy VII just for the FMVs in the middle. It's great.
I think 4K gaming in its sense right now doesn't really matter to me. Just because graphics and everything like that are there for certain reasons. I think pushing it to the limit, you know, you just got to then make bigger and bigger systems and then bigger, you know, bigger price tags. So you're just like...
And at some point, you can't tell the difference.
Right.
That's where you're going to get to at some point. It's going to look to the point where it's too real.
Right. And I think at that point, once you're going over there, people are going to get really uncomfortable with it. They've tested that with, you know, some VR and high definition sets where people get really uncomfortable because their body immediately thinks that everything they're seeing is real. Mm-hmm. Whereas like VR now, you kind of have like a slight screen door effect, or it's getting better to the point where it's very immersive, but you kind of,
you have moments where you're like, I'm playing a game.
Yeah, this is just a game. Yeah. You know, like when you're playing Batman, okay, I don't see my arm, mm-hmm. but you know, it's like, cool, I can still throw batarangs. You know, where I think once that happens, it'll have to be implemented very slowly to get people used to it. Otherwise, you're just going to have a bunch of people like, I don't feel comfortable playing that at all.
Yeah. It'll be to the point where they, whatever they see is basically, they'll take as truth, essentially, is what it sounds like. Where it's like, if I put you into a World War II shooter, how traumatic is that to you? Because that's what you're looking at.
Right.
Thing. Like, you are that person shooting the other person. And, I mean,
I don't think 4K is that high fidelity.
It's four times 1080p.
I've seen 4K things though, and I don't immediately
true 4K
assume
or have you seen
real.
Streaming 4K? Because true 4K.
Whatever they show fantastic. At Costco when you're walking by
those
videos.
Are probably it depends on what they stream or what they play them on. But true 4K video is gorgeous.
So I remember the just first time we got like a super high definition TV, the one that is behind you, that is that we use it, for our gaming. It's a 3D TV. It's all fancy.
It's all fancy.
When that matters. 120
3D Wi-Fi.
Hertz. Yeah, all that fun stuff.
Full 80.
So full HD. When I first started watching movies and stuff on there, it threw me off because they looked like soap operas. Mm-hmm. Like they had this kind of weird like hyper realism to them, which just made me dislike them because mm-hmm. it didn't have that movie kind of sheen that you get when you watch something.
Do you think that was just content creators not knowing how to use their technology yet?
No, I think it was just my eyes getting used to the idea of that high quality, that it looks like a video camera as opposed mm-hmm. to like an actual movie.
Yeah. Because the other thing is frame rate will affect that as well big time.
Yeah.
From a video perspective.
Yeah. And for games, I don't know. I just think like I haven't played a true 4K game, so I really don't know how I feel about it yet. Mm-hmm. I know that I'm probably going to be blown away the first time I do. I don't think it'll be the same experience as how blown away I was with VR, because that was like a whole new way mm-hmm. to play. This is essentially the same thing, just higher fidelity graphics, which is great. And, you know, smoothness and frame rate and all those beautiful things that come along with it. But I don't know if it matters yet, because I don't think enough people have the capability
to do it.
Because 4K TVs are still
from
pricey.
A console standpoint, now both consoles have 4K capabilities and mm-hmm. HDR, which I think HDR is a bigger deal than 4K personally, just because you have 1080p HDR TV and it doesn't have to be 4K to do mm-hmm. HDR, which is kind of cool. But my take on the whole 4K thing is it depends on how they use it, how they use that resolution. Are they going to use it for more detail in the world? Like at some point, like Cody's saying, the 4K, you're pushing four times the amount of these boxes are pushing already. That price point's going to skyrocket
for a little while,
it'll come back down at some point, but it's going to skyrocket initially.
Do you mean for the games?
No, just for the hardware.
Oh, okay.
Just to run it. I mean, the fact that we can run VR on a PlayStation is amazing if you look at the specs that are inside of a PlayStation compared to like what you need on a computer to run a Vive or a Oculus. But let's take The Witcher. The Witcher is a fantastic looking game. I don't think if I saw it in 4K, if I saw them side by side, I would tell the difference and I would know the difference. But I think if you told me, if I played a game Witcher in 1080p and I was like, this is The Witcher and that's it, I wouldn't be like, oh, I'm missing something. But I'm sure if it was the other way, if you showed me something in 4K and then went back to 1080p, it's kind of like how when I played with the Vive and I went back to PSVR, I was like, I see what I'm missing here, versus you've not had the experience of playing with the Vive, so you don't see kind of the other side of it.
No.
So it, like you said, it kind of depends. If you have a 4K TV, I think it's worth it, and I think 4K is coming. I don't think it's here yet. I think right now Sony and Microsoft are setting themselves up. I'm interested to see what Scorpio is and how that handles all
this.
It
almost feels like they're jumping over 4K though, because there's already places that are doing 8K TV and 8K content. And
well,
you wonder just kind of where it stops.
The problem you have with that is from a media standpoint, 8K cameras have been around for a few years now.
Right.
You you tend to shoot larger than you cut to. So, like, an example, a lot of movies will shoot in 4K, or they'll even shoot in 2.5K to cut it down to 1080p, which is about 2,000. So they'll do that because they have a little bit of room to play with cropping and adjusting and all that kind of stuff, or even color correction. To me, the 4K will be, like I said, I think the HDR is going to be more important, but the colors, the vibrancy, the details you can put in there. But I don't know, I've never been a graphics guy. Like, think of the games I play right now on there. Like, yes, Inside looked fantastic, but I could play that 1080p, I could play it 720p, it doesn't matter. Like, I think this affects AAA games more than anything else. Like,
yeah.
By far and away.
There are certain games that come out with each console that I think are designed to showcase the prowess of Uncharted.
Uncharted is the game for PlayStation 4.
Exactly.
Right now.
And I think for those games, it's going to be a big deal. For other ones, I think, as most gamers feel, you're always looking at, like, gameplay and, like, how much enjoyment do I get out of this? Would Fallout be cool in 4K? I'm sure it would be. Yes. But at the same time, it's not going to give you any less of an experience to just play it.
Because one of the debates I heard brought up by, I think it was IGN or something, was would you rather have 1080p 60 frames per second solid on a console, which, yes, I know PCs can do that already, but from console standpoint
I can't tell the difference.
Or I got old man eyes. Oh, I can. Or do you want 4K at 30? Because there's this basically the same amount of power to run both, pretty close to the same amount of power to run both. The 1080p 60 is a little bit less, but not that much if you look at what you need to do both. And it makes a good point. So, like, would you rather have the smoothness or do you rather have it look pretty? Type thing. So, like, for a fast motion game, I'd rather have the smoothness. Like a Titanfall, I think 360 would be better than 4K.
I would lean on the side of smoothness, I think. Smoothness or fidelity?
What's your take on it?
It depends. When I play, I don't have a 4K TV. I have a high definition television from 7 years ago that I don't sit right up against anymore. And truly, I guess for me, I've never noticed. You know, I can see the dip. You know, if it drops from, you know, 30 to like 10, like if it's a drastic change.
Like, Fallout has those chugging moments where you're just like,
And that's like, typically there's a lot going on. Mm-hmm. And with my system and how the PlayStation, you know, some games are built for a more beefy system, but they're kind of just forced on the PlayStation 4 because they're there. Kind of like Skyrim on the PS3. That game should have really come out on the PS4 because that's the only console that could really handle it at that point. You put it on the 360, you know, the 360 of the PS3, not going to work very well.
What was it, Call of Duty, where they like completely changed assets because the 360 and PS3 could not handle the assets they used? It was the first Call of Duty that came out on PS4, and they literally went in and changed assets because it could not handle it.
Yeah, or Destiny, when the PS3 version and the PS4 version are both at the same time.
I had no idea Destiny was on PS3.
Yep. Yeah, they actually had to, once the expansion came out, they stopped
supporting
the PS3 because it put so many restrictions on that game.
Well, that's the same thing with GTA. Like, I'm excited to see Red Dead just because it's the first Rockstar game built on the new generation.
Now, if there's a game that you want to see in 4K... Red Dead would be pretty
sweet. Rockstar in general.
Yeah, but I mean, truthfully though, like, I'm not that person. Like, I honestly, like, as long as the game plays, I guess smooth would be preferable.
Yeah.
But then again, like, the game's gonna look beautiful regardless to me. Like, I go back and play Dreamcast games all the time, and it's still beautiful because I can take where they were with the technology and how they made it, and it's always going to be that way. It's like watching like watching old,
like when I look at Mario 64, like, yes, that's butt ugly now compared to what we have, but it still looks gorgeous if you take it in that time capsule and you're like, okay, this is what they did versus X-Squad. Those next gen graphics were not so good on X-Squad.
Yeah.
So I get what you're saying, where you got to remember the time and place when things came out. And the only other concern I have with this is kind of like you brought up, are we in the resolution wars? Like, where does this stop? And that's why I was super excited for VR, because it is a new way to play versus make things look prettier. I'd rather have people spend, similar to what you're saying, have people spend time on the game and make the gameplay better than make it look super pretty. Like, Uncharted, I think that works really well because it's both. If Uncharted just looks super pretty and the gameplay sucked, do you think that game would sell? It would sell initially, but it would just drop
The first
off.
Game had some of those problems where the gameplay was not that solid.
I couldn't get through.
But
because of some of the gun mechanics.
It got better. But I think that the immersiveness of a game is a big factor, and if the 4K can contribute to the immersiveness of a game, then that's a good thing. But otherwise, most gamers, like, they play games for the same reason why people watch movies. It's escapism. They want to be able to, like, enter this world for a couple hours and just completely lose themselves, which is why VR is going to be such a big hit. But for 4K, like, that can definitely improve some of that sort of experience, but I don't think it's integral to it.
And I don't want to knock on it. I think 4K is, like I said, I think it's coming. I don't want to say, like, fuck 4K, like, nobody needs it, but it's kind of like how I look at VR. It's not necessarily for
everybody.
It'll
be a slow, gradual process. Everyone eventually will adopt it, but I don't think it's going to take the world by storm.
Yeah, because the other thing is kind of like, your TV's 7 years old. I bought a TV 3 years ago, and I'm not going to replace it anytime soon. I got a 50-inch TV in my living room that...
They are getting cheaper 4K TVs, but they're not there.
Yeah, but I spent $1,200 on Panasonic Plasma 3 years ago. I'm not going to replace that until it dies.
I think once 4K... I think once DVDs disappear and they stop...
DVDs are still standard definition.
Right. I mean, once we become standard, you know, high definition 4K,
Blu-ray and streaming services.
Right. Once those become standard at a higher resolution, we're going to see a massive swing towards the 4K revolution, where it comes out to TVs are just now standard 4K, and this is standard, and this is standard. Right now, we're still pumping out these really shitty DVDs and these streaming services that are pumping out just normal normal definition content. Standard. And so there's no reason for people to be like, well, I want to watch movies, but I don't want to have to go buy the $50 Blu-ray, then buy the, you know, $3,000 TV to watch it.
Whereas, and, sorry, you go for it. I was just going to say, the other thing you mentioned there was actually... very important, which you talked about how the content isn't really there, and that a lot of people, how they consume their media now is differently. So you have a lot of people that focus on things like Netflix and Hulu and that kind of stuff, and even though Netflix has 4K streaming, as we know, the internet in general in America isn't really good enough to handle
Netflix 4K
streaming.
Is not your I mean, as somebody who's a video guy, like, Netflix 4K is not 4K, it's fucking marketing, and it makes me The term UHD, Ultra HD, makes me so mad, because Ultra HD means it can be, there's like four different things it can be. And I'm just like...
It's, well, it's the same as when they do like 4G LTE and stuff. There's like different, there's like 10 different levels of 4G.
But think about 1080p though. The reason I like, even HD, I guess you had HD 720p, 1080i, 1080p, but eventually it got to the point where 1080p was HD. Like, that's just the way it is, because technologies will get there. Until I think we have that standard... I think 4K is in a world of hurt. Same thing with HDR right now. There's two versions of HDR. PlayStation and Microsoft both support one. I think it's HDR10 is the name of the technology. So what happens to the other one that Dolby, or not Dolby, DLP is making?
The way, like, Betamax.
It's the whole HD DVD versus Blu-ray concept type thing. So until we have a standard, I'm scared.
Poor HD DVDs.
Yeah.
Do you remember them?
They're real expensive now.
I've got one somewhere. So my dad gave it to me. I don't know why he thought I was able to watch it, but I was like, all right.
Yeah, I'll take it. Even Blu-rays aren't 4K for the most part, because they can't put enough data.
Mm. Yeah,
I mean, it's crazy.
They had a, you know, it's, Blu-rays were such a great, you know, marketing. It's like, hey, we can get twice the amount of information with a blue laser, and that was fantastic. And I'm so happy that Sony just like immediately threw that into the PS3 and PS4, and, you know, Microsoft definitely lagged a little bit with, you
know, 360,
right?
They fell down
on the side of HD.
Yeah, they basically voted on the wrong thing back in the day. But the problem I have with Blu-ray currently, and this is kind of getting off topic, but is that it's kind of too little, too late, because streaming service Netflix. Once Netflix came, like, I guarantee that at some point we will have a console that does not have a disc drive in it. Because think about how much room a disc drive takes up inside of a console, and how much heat it generates, and how much noise it generates.
And it's moving parts.
Yeah. We'll eventually get rid of it. I mean, I don't think there's any time, I don't think that's next generation. But we are getting to the point where if the internet's able to get faster...
I hope so in a way, but also that would make me sad to not have physical media for that. Because there's a lot of people that rely on physical media and like having a catalog of games. And
I agree.
You know, there's still the same people that... I almost think it will remain separate. If you look at things like ebooks and regular books are not going away anytime soon, but ebooks are very popular, and a lot of people, you know, primarily and purely just get their stuff electronically. So I think it'll end up being more like that than a case of it being disappearing completely. If you look at the consoles that have done that previously, like the PSP Go, didn't work out so well. So it's kind of, you know, and also hard drive space is going to be a commodity, and until you can get those hard drives for cheaper.
You know, it'd be really cool, and I don't know if, I mean, it's not confirmed, but Switch uses some sort of card. If you could download the game and flash it to a card,
yeah,
like you could flash it to a thumb drive or something like that, so you like still have.
You could make your own physical media.
So like,
yeah,
because one of the
but then piracy would be fucking through the roof.
But it'd have to authenticate somehow. If you had an online authentication, like you could do kind of like, let's use the example of like renting a movie from iTunes. At some point, that's going to authenticate and say, hey, your rental's up. We got to ding it. So you, if you're offline, say you flash a game, you have 30 days offline to play it. You have to go back online and authenticate. After 30 days, if it's not authenticated, that game will not load.
I think that has its own challenges because that's kind of what Xbox was going to do with the original Xbox One, or at least the original plan for the plan Xbox. For it,
which is backlash.
Right. And so I think, you know, at that point, if you like, hey, I own this game, and like this goes along with like the older consoles where people want to preserve their games and things like
which
that.
Which I love. I mean, his shelf's literally behind the camera over there, but I love looking at the shelves and the physical medias.
Right.
So cool.
But once those kind of get to a certain age, you want to then take those, put them somewhere else, and keep the original with, you know, the old Sega discs, PlayStation, those can get scratched or damaged, and then they're not playable. So I have quite a few friends that take those and save them onto the computer and then take them, put them back on a different disc. So they have these games that can just load and go. And so they're kind of disposable at that point.
This is, again, kind of a side chat to what's going on. My phone keeps vibrating.
We should get back to the question.
Yeah, we will. But yeah. I got one more thing on this on this topic here. So, like, one of the things I've understood why video game developers or publishers, like why they've never done it, is if I buy a version of a game, why can't I get it both physically, digitally, and on all platforms?
That would
be
cool.
There's money involved. I have a feeling that's the primary reason. But how cool would it be to buy Overwatch? I buy it on PS4. Oh, I have friends on PC. If I have a PC that can run, why can't I just download that game? I already own that license, but that license is for PS4 only. Like, even if it was $5 more, do you get like an unlocked.
I like the cross buys that they have going on when you buy it for PS4 and you get it for Vita as well, but I think a physical / digital cross buy would be amazing.
Yes, because I play
much like what they did with movies when you would just type in the iTunes code or whatever and have access.
My big complaint right now with playing with VR is I have a few physical games, which is a dumb idea because you have to take the headset off to change games. Like that's a big complaint. One of the reasons I don't play VR as much as I do, or don't switch games as much as I do, because I hate taking that damn headset off to switch the game, go set it back up. I know it's easy to do.
At the same time, it's almost like a built-in break.
Yeah, but I don't want that. I don't want to consume as much.
You
want to
fry your brain.
Yeah, instead. I just want to go.
Sure.
But it's already fried.
Yeah, it's already done. So getting back to Blue's question. So we did, does 4K, what does it bring to the table? How long do you think it will take to fully implement 4K? If it is coming, and I think we can all agree it is coming. Like it's
5 years.
5 years. Do you think it'll be on the next quote unquote console cycle generation?
Oh, I think the games will be there, like available, but I don't think that 4K is going to be widespread until about 5 years, three to five years, because those prices are going to start dropping. And right now we're almost like the early stages of Blu-ray, where like only like crazy early technology.
You buy the PS3 to get a Blu-ray player because other Blu-ray players are $1,000.
Right. So I think that I would say 3 to 5 years is a acceptable level before we start seeing it be commonplace.
I think it depends on what the big companies do. Mm-hmm. You know, where you have Apple, who has already implemented, like, you know, 5K displays in their computers. And then that kind of spawned, you know, Dell, HP, and all these other guys to start putting those kind of... So once you kind of get the big companies to start just standardizing these kind of displays, that will then, for content creators and gamers and all these other places, like, cool, let's just make it for that. Let's get it to the point where we're pumping out games that can be played at 4K at their best, but then also are kind of backwards compatible for the people who can't afford it.
It's kind of like, I hate to use this analogy with gaming, but it's kind of where we're heading, but it's kind of like mobile, like on an iPhone. If you get an iPhone 7 Plus, your screen is a higher resolution than if you have an iPhone 5. And it's just the game auto-adjusts to what's going. There's times where I load up Tuber Simulator, and I can see it adjust itself when I launch the game.
Yep.
Or a slider.
Do you want to know something embarrassing?
Sure.
I was waiting for a response. I didn't know if you did. When I first got my PlayStation 4 in this country, I was using 3, sorry, in this country. I was using standard definition cables. I had a HDMI cable. I bought one. I didn't realize I had to change the settings. So for 8 months, I had
running that
HDMI cable plugged in that I wasn't using. I was going through standard definition. God. So it took me 8 months to figure out how to get HDMI. And as soon as I got it, I was like, whoa!
On my 360, I had the original 360 before HDMI that had the little flip switch thing on it.
That was the worst.
So I had, in my basement, I have a 24-inch, like, giant-ass TV that I used to play everything on when friends would come over. But I'm playing by myself. I had this little 15-inch computer monitor, 1080p. So I'd play Halo on that because it looked better and I could shoot shit better. But when you have friends, you can't look at a screen this big.
Yeah.
So I played standard definition for a long time until that 360 finally had the Red Ring of Death for the third time and got the S. And then even then, I think we didn't have an HDTV in my basement. I had to take it upstairs to play on HD. God, my 360 life was all standard definition.
That's what I'm saying. It's like there's this slow roll of adoption. That's why I think.
Gives you the option. So it'll be interesting, kind of like you're saying, it'll give you the option of 1080p versus 4K because it would be dumb to be like, this can't play on 1080p because game developers want to put their game on as many things as they can that makes the most money,
and I'm sure it doesn't take much for them to
scale back.
Yeah, because it's like, hey, we can go up here, you know, what's it going to take for us just to like change the resolution, just like on, you know, any computer monitor that you have.
Well, most games are built on computers and then scaled back to consoles, especially when they don't know what the console is, like the PS4. What are the final specs? A lot of people don't know, and it's Sony giving them an estimate of what they're working on for a launch game, and then like, oh, here's the final specs, let's scale back to that.
Or the old school tester kits that they would send out, like the big honking things that they would send out to developers that were nowhere near, you know, the actual like specs of the unit, but they could build games that would play on the final unit.
Yeah.
And I thought that was like, you had testing ports, you had all these different ones, like most of them had like VGA and like all these other like just peripherals that they'll never touch, or they're hidden away in the actual like original unit they never did anything with. And you know, I think halfway they probably don't do that anymore, but finding those like tucked away and all dusty, it's like, this is what they used to create games on. This is insane. My original TV, the one that I had for 7 years, that was actually my original computer monitor when I got my big gaming computer, you know, 7 years ago, or no, more than that. Anyway, it's very old. That was always HDMI, but it was like DVI to HDMI, so it was never true.
So you didn't get audio through it.
I had to turn on my
Composite could do 1080i, I believe. I don't think it could do full 1080p.
It could try to get up there. It depended on what you were plugging it into. That was
because I know the 360 couldn't do it. It was always 1080i through Composite.
And Nintendo, which is your favorite, the GameCube actually had the chance for Composite, but they were like, nobody wants HD graphics, and completely nixed it. But that thing could have come up to like almost HD graphics, and they could have sold it that much harder, and people would have loved it that much more. But they nixed it, went straight back to the.
They did correct that mistake with the Wii, though. They did
get the Wii U. The Wii was still standard definition.
The Wii you could buy composite cables for.
Yeah, you could. But nobody did.
I did.
Yeah, you're weird.
I did.
Yeah, oh, you're weird.
I think you're weird, I'm sir. Weird. 2-1.
Yeah, the average person didn't.
2-1.
Let's just say that. If it didn't come in the box, the average person probably didn't buy it.
True.
So.
All right, what else you got? What's the end of this question?
That was the end of the question, is how long do you think it'll take to implement it?
Oh, I thought it was a three-part
question. It was. We answered two parts in one.
Oh.
We did.
Aren't we efficient?
Because we did, yeah, we did. Death game and adding. What does it bring to the table? And we kind of discussed that when we were talking about, like, the frame rates, kind of fidelity of everything, but I don't know. That was a good question for Blue.
It's a great question.
I said it last week. James made fun of me because I made fun of him, but I'm always intrigued to see what these people, what they come up with, because I don't.
We sit there and sometimes we struggle with an idea for a question. Yes. So this is helpful when people make suggestions. So thank you, Blue. Blue,
if you want to make a suggestion, go to patreon.com/level2gamersstl. And you can be a Patreon supporter and then have the ability to give us a question.
Yeah, and thanks a lot for Drew for that.
Yes,
bonus Blue. Level.
Welcome
to gonna the bonus. That's going to be the sign.
We'll make something.
Yeah, that'd be Ching. Great. All right, what else you got?
That's all I got for the topic here. So let's go on to kind of like what we're looking forward to. What's coming up this next week? So next
Death
week.
And destruction.
There we will not be here. The apocalypse is on. Apocalypse Now.
That was a good movie.
I've never seen it.
It was a good movie.
I've never seen it.
You're not old enough to watch it.
I know.
It
I don't. It's too.
I'll
adult.
Let you know when you're old enough to watch it.
Thanks, Dad. Yeah. But no. What's happening next week? Not really. I mean, nothing much.
Game wise, not a lot.
Yeah,
this week's been kind of boring too. Although Final Fantasy is around a corner. Final Fantasy is around a corner. Fantasy 15. I already have that paid off, ready to go. Can't wait.
It's got VR.
It does have a little bit of VR. I don't know how good that's going to be.
I heard it's
to
real
be
bad.
I'm not particularly.
Yeah, I've heard it's real bad.
I don't really care about that. I just want to play Final Fantasy.
I think we finally, because Titanfall, Call of Duty was kind of like the last round other than Final Fantasy, and then. Because I think everything else got pushed.
Yeah.
So I think December
is going
to be
shit ton of stuff in January, February time coming out, March time. Remember Horizon was the big one. That's been pushed.
The two games I'm excited for in the future is Horizon and For Honor. For Honor, I played the alpha and I fell in love with that game. Really
I still haven't played that yet.
It's so dumb looking. Oh, I got into the, I think I can talk about this. I got into the Steep beta.
Oh.
Again. Nice. So I was in the alpha. I can't talk about what I played in the alpha because NDAs and all that kind of stuff. But I got into the beta. Let's just say I don't enjoy that game at all. I'm not going to buy that game.
Which game?
Steep.
Oh, I thought you said
For Honor.
For Honor beta. I'm just confused.
No. Yeah, For Honor I love. I got into For Honor.
There was no
beta.
Steep
break.
Is the...
You just went straight into Steep and we got totally confused.
Same developer. Yeah. Steep is a snowboard game.
That's the snowboard one.
Yeah,
I was going
to
say.
It's the one at the end of Ubisoft. They're like, here's our new IP. And I was like, that...
Yeah.
Yeah, it's as bad as it looked. Versus For Honor...
Ubisoft.
Was actually pretty good. You were playing with me with that, were you?
Mm-mm. No, that was...
It was James and David, and I gave Weezy to the one.
Yeah. I think the only other thing is mods for console, like PS4 mods.
Skyrim came out recently. I know David's been playing a lot of that.
Yeah, they're finally letting mods happen on
Very
Fallout.
Restrictive.
Which is great. We had a rant at those guys for a while, and I'm happy they finally came and sold their senses on that, and now we can have, you know... Shooting Randy Savage from bazookas.
Well, it has
things.
To be so for consoles. It has to be things that are already in the game, so you can't put a separate art asset in there.
Oh, really?
Yep. So you can't shoot Randy Savage on
so
the console.
It still sucks a little bit.
Yeah.
But if it's like
tweaking
the graphics and things like that,
that's all in game.
That's the stuff that I'm really excited about because they've managed to make some of those games look as realistic as you could possibly imagine.
I wonder what I keep looking at the PlayStation right here, but what the like approval process is that? Like how hard is that on your system?
So from what I've read, because I've watched a lot of people do this, because there's a couple people that I watch that do mod weekly shows and whatnot. The approval process, there's the Steam stuff that they can just throw up and it goes. But you basically can take whatever's on Steam and then send it over to Bethesda. If it's the right size, and because it has to be like a small sized mod, then if they approve it, it'll go right in there and you can download it. The only issue with that is because Bethesda doesn't authenticate with other people, there's been a huge piracy issue where people are actually taking other people's work and sending it over to mods.
Oh, and posting it as their own.
And I think that's
going to be a big
another
issue.
Well, I think that's what kind of was there at the beginning to stop them from sending over, because they couldn't stop people from taking other people's work.
Seeing this, yeah.
And I think it doesn't seem that hard from everybody that I've talked to. It's been pretty simple, like as long as it's the right size and they kind of spell out all the requirements. And there's a couple people out there that are figuring ways to get around that size and like rebuild mods to make them much smaller that do broader things, so you can bring over the best of the best from the mod world over onto the consoles, and that's something that people are really looking forward to.
I'm excited. I know I'm a PlayStation guy, but if I were to get Skyrim right now, I probably would get on Xbox just because you have 5 gigabytes to work with versus one. But talking to David, he said most of the mods are teeny tiny, so it really doesn't matter. But who knows in the future what's going to happen with that? And right now, Microsoft seems to be the friendlier one when it comes to allowing mods. So
which
maybe
is crazy.
Yeah. So maybe like. And down the road, Horizon's going to have... I know this is probably not going to happen, but Horizon has mods. Or Elder Scrolls 6.
I don't know if
there'll
be mods for Horizon, because isn't Horizon a PS exclusive?
That's what I'm saying. You know what I'm saying, though. Yeah. Like, Elder Scrolls 6 is going to have mods. Well,
that would
on
be
PS4,
cool.
God, that'd be amazing.
You can only have 1 gigabyte, but maybe they expand the size of the mod to being 500 megabytes. Well, then you got 2 mods, versus on an Xbox, you can have 5 gigabytes.
Did they ever mod Elder Scrolls Online?
No.
Because you can't really do that, can
you? You couldn't, because it's a public right. server. That's why like with GTA, here, fun little GTA fun fact, you cannot use mods or cheats on GTA Online or you will get kicked off. You can use them on
single player
because that does not affect anybody else. Which I think that's fine. Because if you're fucking with somebody else's game, it's not cool. That's where I think it's
And that is the world of people fucking with other people's games.
Yeah, I mean, I think I told you the time I was playing online on PC and I was standing in my garage and all of a sudden just money rained down on my head. Like, randomly just money kept dropping. I was like, I ended up getting, I think, $32 million in a matter of 12 minutes.
Nice.
I spent it before Rockstar knew what was going on. I was kind of concerned, though, because I didn't know if they're going to be like, where did you get this money from?
I don't think it's your fault if someone makes
He literally made money rain on my head. Like, my garage was full of money bags at one point, and I was like, this is cool.
Yeah, there's
the money stacks.
Or, there, you know, the consoles, like, there's people who can glitch it and stuff like that, so they don't necessarily need to mod it. I think I was playing with Tegrado, and we went in. He was in his garage. Somebody had glitched into his garage and was killing him in the garage.
Yeah.
And it's just, it's like, people will find a way, even if there isn't a mod that they can do, there's a glitch or
people
some
are just
sort
assholes,
of,
is what it comes down to.
Right. There's going to be a way for someone to be like, and you're dead.
I hope they don't mess with that new remaster of Modern Warfare. Because the remaster of Modern Warfare, the original Modern Warfare, was ruined by modders. And by, you'd show up at a game, like, I remember Modern Warfare 2, I had so many of the little banners and titles, and I was like Prestige 8 or something. And then I joined some fucker's game, and everything went away.
I might have had a modded controller for Modern Warfare 2.
Modded controller is different, I think.
Yeah, but I can shoot a lot quicker.
Yeah, you
still, I mean, I can shoot. Close to, yeah. I actually was really good at that game in college, but I could shoot probably 4 to 5 times quicker than the average person, which is good for me because I'm already slow, so it kind of leveled out. But
yeah, there's a bunch of companies that you can buy controllers that, like the pro controllers, that have like switches and stuff like that, and you can change how much
you have to
button.
Pull the...
Yeah, so there's ones that you can like crank it almost all the way down, and it's got a massive spring in it, so all you have to do is click it, and it just immediately just starts firing stuff, and you can remap certain buttons, and it's... So you're like...
It's
you're,
more for like e-sport and
I
stuff
used to
like
make,
that.
So my controller
Call
had...
Call of Duty
had,
mainly, yeah.
Yeah, my controller had triggers on the bottom, kind of like the Pro controller, or the Elite controller for Xbox, and I would just use that as grenades, and then the right side was reload, because that way I didn't have to move...
Have you seen that anywhere. the new Pro PS4 controller?
Which one? There's the one that they officially licensed.
Weirdly shaped
and then there's
one.
A couple other ones.
The official one.
The official one I have. I've seen obviously all three
bizarre
of them.
Shape to it. Kind of like disjointed almost.
Yeah.
I'm not a fan,
no. I think Sony would have to come out and actually make one, but I don't think the DualShock is that bad. The only complaint I have is the joysticks. People have a lot of issues. I know you have issues with them.
Mine the just rubber squeaky. Tearing off.
Yeah. I've not had any issue with mine yet. So
yeah. Both of mine have it.
Yeah, I know. Trust me, I know.
I'm pretty convinced it's a quality control issue at this point.
Well, for me, I've had my PlayStation probably a year after it, like maybe about 2 years now, and like the only issue I have is like the vibrate motors are slowly going out because I can feel that. Like I'll be playing a game like a shooter, Division, or something like that, and I'll be shooting, and I can just feel it, just like, and so it's like there's nothing going on. I'm like, this doesn't feel the same. Okay, there's back. And I was like, just shake it for a moment.
Well,
back.
Was it Brian that like one of his triggers didn't work? So like it would work every so often. We're like, attack him. He's like, I'm trying, and it just didn't work.
Those controllers have had a few problems, I think. I'm not super big fan of the amount of difficulties those DualShock.
But I love them way more than, as somebody who didn't play DualShock 2 and 3, I love the feel of these controllers. From somebody who switched from Xbox to PlayStation, wonderful.
I think PlayStation fanboys that have been using them throughout the years always felt like our controllers were superior because they were smaller.
They're
just easier to... You know, to handle.
I love 360.
We
controller.
Had a guy comment on one of their things the other day saying you can only play Tony Hawk correctly with a PlayStation controller.
And I responded, I've never played it on PlayStation. I've only played it on Xbox.
Yeah, because you suck.
Whoa.
I liked the Xbox controller for the simple fact that it was
Xbox or 360?
Because
360, I think, was the better version of it.
The only really reason I liked the 360 more than the Xbox is because it had the battery part where I could actually kind of like tuck my fingers and kind of get a better grip. The one thing with the PlayStation controllers, and I've liked them, is just because I can actually wrap my hands completely around them and I don't have to let go. Whereas like I can just kind of move certain fingers, where like the bigger the controller, or like the more oddly shaped, and the 360 and the Xbox One controllers kind of get to that point where it's like there's nothing for me to kind of grip. Mm-hmm. And so if I play the game long enough and my hand gets sweaty, like everybody's hands
get sweaty. Did you ever have those controllers with the fans in them? Because they used to have those back in the day.
I had that once, and like it died on me in a week because it was like Mad Cats or something.
Yeah, mine was Mad Cats, like see-through green.
But like, I have to do official. I can't do third-party controllers.
It was cheaper.
It was just like I've always liked the PlayStation controllers a little bit more, just because I can wrap my hands mm-hmm. around them and actually play them. The Xbox controllers, and just throughout the years, the only time I've ever like truly liked it was the 360. Just because I could kind of.
I hate the triggers on Xbox One. I know people love them. I hate them because for shooters it makes sense. For racing it does not, because it's not. You don't get to go as far as you want to. And the other thing, one of my concerns right now with PlayStation 4 is I've not had an issue yet, but rechargeable batteries. At some point they're not going to be able to hold a charge.
Mine's already starting to do that.
Doesn't say how long is that going to be, especially if somebody like I keep my brightness up now because I have the VR. So that way, if I play a VR game, I don't have to go into my settings and change it. But
yeah.
How long does that last?
The battery is actually fairly simple to replace inside the
this guy mod stuff.
Yeah, it's actually quite simple.
We need to fix our, what was it, 64. You need to fix that for us. We need to get the petroleum jelly out. Down one time, Texas Wife, he's like, do we have petroleum jelly? And Jess was like, why? He's like, me and Keegan need some. And I can only imagine what the face looked like.
It's probably like this, like,
What's happening?
God damn it, Keegan.
She's come to accept these things.
Yeah. But there's actually a big section of people who have had, you know, the joysticks go out, the triggers go out, batteries, all that kind of stuff. The only thing that, like, the battery itself is just a quick, like, pop out and pop mm-hmm. in, thankfully. But it's the other stuff that you have to, like, re-solder and, like, reattach. Yeah.
My touchpad's gotten a little smoother just over time of me, because in Elder Scrolls? Yeah, it's the map in Elder Scrolls. So just, I touch it in the same spot, so it literally just smoothed out where I've touched it every time.
Yeah.
So
I was going to say, my joysticks, I haven't had those wear out on me. Like, they're completely fine.
Dude, it's the rubber. Yeah.
I can't pull it up here, but there you go. It's rubber. You won't be able to see it.
Yeah.
Yours are probably worse of anybody's I've seen, so I don't know if it's a you thing.
It's not. I swear to God. I've been on the forums, and there's lots of people that have the same problem with that rubber there. Just at the bottom of the left stick, it's always the same place. It just kind of tears easy and opens
That's
up.
That's what she said.
I have both of my controllers have.
Yeah. Have you gotten the little condoms for them?
No.
Have you heard of those? Like, you can buy them at GameStop.
Have you heard of condoms?
They're little, like, silicone mats that you can put on them, and there's also extenders for people with bigger hands.
Mm.
So you can actually extend the reach for your thumbs, so it's a little more comfortable.
My thumbs don't go very far.
I feel like...
So, yeah.
I feel but like we're in bonus level right now talking about controllers.
We've definitely moved past...
The 4K.
Regular territory.
I think it's interesting when it comes to, like the controllers, because it's...
That makes the system. If the controller is not comfortable, you're not going to have people who want the system.
Yes.
That was the major reason they redid the original Xbox's controller.
The Duke,
because people could... I love that controller just because it was so big.
Now I do. When I was a kid, I didn't.
I loved it regardless.
Because my hands were too tiny.
I still hate it.
Yeah. Well, you know why? You know why they made it that big? Because the logic board, the board they had inside, they couldn't make it small enough. The board isn't underneath that Xbox.
Then... Get a better engineer, Microsoft.
They did, like, shortly after that.
Yeah.
Well, there you go.
Yeah.
They fixed the problem.
The only reason I truly like that the Xbox, the original, the Duke, is because I played Phantasy Star Online way too much. Like, my parents were like, why am I paying for this game? Like, you don't stop. but, like...
It never ends.
But because everything kind of fit nice flush on that controller, and I could play that for hours and hours, and I never felt like my hands got cramped. Mm-hmm. Whereas, like... And it's not so much now.
You feel like your knuckles touch.
Yeah, it's the controller is a little bit smaller. My hands are much bigger than they were back then. Yeah. But like, for long term gaming,
big hands, big gloves,
big fingers.
Yeah.
Anyway.
But no, I was the opposite. When I first got the Duke controller, I hated it because I got the original Xbox and that was that. Like, that's
isn't
the
one it sitting over there.
Yeah, it's actually the one right over there, and that's actually the original controller. I have an S controller somewhere, but it doesn't work because I played it so much that I literally had worn it out.
Yeah. We got to do some messing with some of the, like I'm hopefully moving to a different place at some point here soon, and we're gonna have a proper setup where I clean up.
You should support us on Patreon.
Help vintage Tom's selection. Help me move. Yes, yeah. Just a couple hundred thousand mortgage should do payment. It.
Yeah. But no, I think it's funny if you. I'm gonna go nostalgic here for a second because we're talking about the old games. But
we
started this. What, almost 2 years ago? Year and a half, 2 years ago now?
We started this gangster shit, and this is the motherfucking thanks we get.
I'm done. February 5th of 2014?
This is a self life because I got that right.
2014.
Reference.
15. 2015. Because we're in 2016 now. February 5th, 2015 was when we started.
Almost 2 years. I remember that day. I was probably one of your only people that watched consistently.
Probably.
I still kind of watch.
Yeah. Roxy was too. Charming Cuisine follows us.
I just get really bored of your voice. Yeah. Because I have to listen to it almost every time I play a game.
Yeah. That's true. But no, it's funny because like when we started, I bought the Super Nintendo we have because...
You have two.
Yeah. Well, now, yeah. But I bought it at the time because I wanted it for the show. Mm. And it's kind of expanded. Like you bought a lot of the consoles, but I brought my Xbox over so we could have it for the show. Mm. I mean, Tegrado.
Your NES.
Yeah, my Ness is at my house.
Yeah, right now. It was here for
but
a
it
while.
Was here. But yeah. Then Tegrado gave us an Xbox One for the show. Like, our goal is to eventually have all of them. So I'd love the retro games because that's what we grew up on. Your retro is a little bit more retro than my retro.
We're gonna be getting more into that. I think. I think it's definitely something that will probably show up more on like Friday videos and stuff, where we'll just go like deep into the retro past for some things, or you know,
go to yesteryear. The only thing we don't have is an Atari. I think because we have.
I've looked at several, but I haven't picked one up.
We have quite a few.
I found a few people who have Ataris.
There's a few. Yeah, we don't have a Sega CD. Our 32X.
Those are on my wish. Yeah, the Sega CD and the 32X. Those are so hard to come by, the system themselves, but the cables. Mm-hmm. Because for some reason, Sega loved cables. Yep. And that was like, I've come across so many at like decent prices, but it's like no power cable or no connector cable, so it's just a useless
unit.
Yeah, but like,
can you not buy like knockoff versions on Amazon? I've had to buy most of my like AV cables and stuff.
They were Amazon. Very
well, hello.
The cables themselves, no one's like, I guess because people just don't care and there's not a whole lot of money in it because there's so few.
Yeah, most people
don't produce those kind of cables anymore, and they were very rare to begin with because the 32X wasn't around very, very long before they mixed it and went on to the next.
It up.
Right. Well, they kept trying to make the Genesis a thing.
Because the Genesis was so good. That's
first attempt at a modular upgrade to a console, I suppose. Yeah. Right?
I mean, the CD did fairly well. Not like great, but it did fairly well. And it literally just attach it. The very first version, you just kind of slid it on top. And then the second version, you slid it to the side. And then you could play your CDs and things like that. That became a lot of people's very first stereo. And, you know, it was just fantastic. And I think if they would have just released a CD console before that and just kind of nixed it, or at least kind of created one that did all of it, I think there was...
As opposed to making it an add-on.
Yeah.
Right. There was the Generation 3 Genesis that did all of them. Mm-hmm. And I think that's where they should have just skipped to.
Were they limited by the... I don't know much about the Sega CD because I was not a Sega guy. Were they limited by the chips inside the Genesis, I'm guessing? Because if they kind of rewrote the system, they could have made it more powerful.
I think there was the expansion ports and things on there. So they originally planned on all that, but I believe that was one of the reasons they did expand it, is because they had to add another motherboard to it to handle it. So everything ran through the original Genesis. That's where it got its power and its display capabilities. But it needed basically a whole nother system.
Wait, you're saying it's kind of like the box that you get for PSVR? Where you need a whole other system to run the headset?
Yeah.
Yeah, and...
Craziness.
But I mean...
Good job, Sony.
And then, you know, the PlayStation comes out and just kind of wrecks whatever Sony was trying, or whatever Sega was trying to do. And then the PS2 becomes the biggest
thing of all time.
Well, wasn't the PlayStation originally supposed to be...
So Nintendo and PlayStation partnered. So Did You Know Gaming? I don't know if you follow them. I was like, what are you doing?
There's a hair.
Oh.
I think it was
Did You Know Gaming? They have a good one on kind of how this all came about. But basically, Sony and Nintendo partnered. It was called the Nintendo PlayStation was the name of the console. And it was supposed to play the cartridges from Nintendo and the CDs from Sony. Or the were they CDs at that point? They were CDs at that point, CD-ROMs,
yeah.
I'm guessing at that point.
Early days of PlayStation.
Yeah. So then they did that, and then for whatever reason, Nintendo got cold feet, and at some conference, the next day, they talked about the partnership they had with Philips and kind of said, fuck you, Sony. So Sony went on, and Sony actually wasn't going to make the PlayStation. There's only a small group of people that kind of pushed it and pushed it and pushed it, and now look what it's become.
Now
and
it then, is the biggest part of their business.
And then the only reason Microsoft is in the gaming industry is because, I can't remember who went to Bill Gates, but somebody went to Bill Gates and said, what if Sony owns a living room? Microsoft wasn't caring about games. So, like, we have PC games. Why do we need to care about that? But
yep.
DVDs, Blu-rays, eventually, well, they eventually screwed that one up. But, like, DVDs, CDs, like, they're going to own the living room. And that's scary for a company. Like, oh, shit, we don't have, we're just the gaming PC side
we're,
of things.
We're just an office, yeah.
Yeah, we don't have the family. We don't have the home.
Well,
which is why they focus so heavily on that as well.
Yeah, they screwed that. Don Matrick is... Yeah. Fucking things up left, right, and center.
Well, from the very similar story to the Nintendo Sony thing, but from what I heard, and this could just be another part of that, was that Nintendo was like, Sony doesn't make games, why would we partner with them? Mm-hmm. And they're like, nah, we can do this on our own. Mm-hmm. So is that very much like Nintendo like just some of attitude?
It, well, some of it came to licensing because Sony wanted to own the license to every CD game that was made, in Nintendo being Nintendo. Because remember, Nintendo owned the market share in the early 90s. Like Genesis, yes, took it, but Nintendo was still king of the hill by far and away, just because they were the first one there. Now look at it, but yeah. They're on last.
And I think it was Philips that kind of ruined the
CDI was horrible.
I owned one.
It was
my dad bought one. I actually owned one of the rarest non-Nintendo Zelda games. Mm-hmm. I don't know where it is now. I think my dad gave it away, not thinking.
Yeah.
But it was... they gave up. They're like, yeah, you can totally make a Zelda game. So they gave mm-hmm. him a voice. It was this like crazy cartoon. Like yep. They made three games.
And that's why Nintendo's so protective of their stuff now, is because shit like that, the Mario movie, like
they basically let someone else make the decision. Be like, yeah, let's totally do this, and it completely like tanked.
Yeah.
And so now they're very much like, we aren't doing anything. It is all ours. We will not let you touch it. And
but
I think
you can't do it in a day and age like this.
Right.
Well, they started to open a bit more with Switch. I think they're allowing more.
We'll see.
But I still don't think they're going to let like their head franchises be controlled by anyone.
No, they'll never do that. One of the things I really, 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 really want back is I want Rare and Nintendo to do something. Hmm. I don't care what it is. I just want Microsoft to be like.
Well, the thing is, Rare are just not really Rare anymore. They're just like there's very few people from that original.
Well, that's where
Ukulele.
Yeah, what's the name of them? Playtonic Games is. Rare, so that's what's coming out next year. I forgot about that. I kickstarted that, so that's coming out.
I remember you talked about that when you first did that. I'm still like, because I've only done one Kickstarter, and that is already like extending more and more. I'm like, I just dumped money into you, and you have yet to like
not give me anything.
They've updated it, you know, and I understand like because of the and this I kickstarted the it was a battery pack that looked like a Pokedex, and so it was
for
Pokemon Go, and so I backed that, and when the Samsung batteries started to pop, apparently like the entire corporation that was making batteries was also helping make batteries for Samsung, so everything got locked down, and so they have had to do like minute and like just almost pure ridiculous testing on a safety side of things. I'm not against that, but it like threw everything for a loop.
Yeah.
And the poor company that like these guys that are just like wanting to make it are like,
I'm sorry, we can't do anything. But that's why with like Ukulele, it was supposed to come out in October. It was supposed to be out by now, but I knew when they announced the date it was not going to happen. But what makes me
really
excited
fast.
Is that, yeah, what makes me excited though is the fact that they've gone in and they've shown the toy box, and they like IGN was able to show off that. I didn't back the toy box level. I just got the game. I didn't want to go any higher because I didn't know if
where
it would
be
worth
go,
it or
yeah.
not. So watching that makes me excited, though. It's literally Banjo-Kazooie, just a new skin, which is good and bad. I mean, you're doing the same thing. They obviously can't do that over and over and over. They got to change it up.
But they don't
also,
do those types of games very often.
But they
anymore,
also did Conker's.
Yeah.
That's the other thing you got to keep in mind is they did Conker's Bad Fur Day, and I would love picture a Conker's Bad Fur Day on a PS4 because you have a more mature audience. Nintendo, at the time, not so mature.
I mean, we already said that Ratchet and Clank did particularly well with the material that they had available to them in the PS4.
Loved Ratchet and Clank.
Yeah. So that
the remake?
That style.
Not the remake. No. I was just version? I was just there for the rise of Ratchet.
And Clank. I love the I've never played until
the newest one is incredibly beautiful.
Yeah.
Like it is.
And Game I've watched everything I possibly can about that.
Did you watch level2gamers.com?
Maybe. But the that was kind of like the rise and fall of was it Crash Bandicoot as Sony, and then Ratchet and Clank came and just completely took over that corporation as a this is where we want to be.
And you had Jack and Daxter too.
Jack and Daxter,
but they never did as well.
Sly Cooper.
Yeah. Sly Cooper. They had these massive characters that they had driven, but I think Ratchet and Clank is the only one that has stuck around, because the other ones have slowly kind of drifted into something else. Because Jack and Daxter 3 wasn't so much Jack and Daxter or Jack and Daxter 2. It turns into a pseudo racing game.
And it's also because they maybe not the same developers are doing them too. Right. That's, I mean, it's crazy to think that Naughty Dog did Crash Bandicoot, the same company that did Uncharted and then The Last of Us, made this fucking animated Bandicoot back in the day. And
some companies will surprise you.
I really want them to go back.
The company that did they did all of the God of War games on the PSP, and they were the ones that made The Order, which, you know, as shitty as that may have turned out to be in some aspects, was a hell of a game. And considering that their prior experience was all just Vita games and porting kind of an original series anyway, that was super impressive that they could pull that out.
So. Keegan, are you trying to say you want to make games great again?
Oh, God. No. I want Naughty Dog to make whether it's the 25th anniversary, I want them to make another Crash Bandicoot game.
I want them to make a VR game.
A VR Crash Bandicoot Warped?
Dude, you get so dizzy because you'd spin. That's my spinning animation. But no,
That it's an animation.
Yeah.
All right.
That's a noise. It does.
That's a seizure. Is what that is.
No, I only played Crash Bandicoot when I went to hotels because I never had a PlayStation. So they had this weird controller that had all the buttons for every controller imaginable from the Sheridan, by the way, Sheridan Fredericton. New Brunswick, Canada. I used to go there all the time.
Spons, but not Spons. Wish was Spons.
By Sheraton?
You know.
They're all right. They have nice shower heads.
Like free hotels.
We should get sponsored by them. I don't know how to say their name.
You're the only person that drinks that.
I know, but
and
I
you
love
don't
them.
Even know how to pronounce it.
I don't.
It's bye.
But it's good. It's bye. Say it's bye.
Bye.
It's bye antioxidant.
Bye.
So.
Well, it's like the Sony PlayStation PS2 TVs. You ever see those?
No.
So they came out these line of TVs that had a PlayStation built into the base. Mm. So you just hit a button and you can play all your games from the TV. So you didn't actually have to do anything.
Oh, that's dope.
Yeah. Sony, they really tried to push
Sony. I mean, Sony owns TVs.
Well yeah. I mean, it's, well, they anymore. Just, they tried to like merge so much. They only made a few hundred of those guys.
I want the Walkman PS4. Cool idea, though. It's a portable one. You just put some cool little ugly headphones on. You walk around. You listen to your games. Cool soundtracks.
Jesus Christ.
Oh.
There we go.
There's a guy that I follow. I don't think he does them anymore. But he was classic gaming. It was his thing. It was a character that the guy played, Keith Apicary. And he did that, where he would walk around with a Sega and a Sega CD and listen to his tunes. He's like, it's great for portable on-the-go action. And he was really big into the Sega Nomad, and it was just these stupid little videos, but people wanted to do stuff like that, where it's I have the CD player, I'm going to take it with me, but it's I have to take a controller. Yeah. and people were completely fine with it when that was the norm. Now it's I have to have I have to add something. No, I'm done. I'm not
done.
I'm not buying.
Game over.
I have to buy a dongle.
Alrighty. Well, so. I think I'm sleepy, and you are insane, and you need to do some candy stuff.
Do you want some candy?
Yeah, I mean we could do that. We could end on the candy part, I guess. So you brought some special candy for us.
Yep. This
it looks like that one's been pre-chewed.
I'm a little scared.
This is candy from my very first Candy Tuesday.
Okay.
I brought two of each. One, except, because Keegan...
I can't do spicy. I have medical things going on. That is not allowed to eat spicy.
So,
it might kill me. No joke.
So this is German salted licorice.
It looks like a piece of chalk. So cheers.
So these...
I'm just scared.
I know, right?
I don't have a lot of drink
left. I was going to say, get the drink ready. Dude, Tom, you got to go for it. Whole thing.
So it's like a mint candy shell with like traditional black licorice on the inside with a center.
Woo! You know, I'm not a licorice guy, but that's not bad.
It for me, I didn't like it at all.
I don't think I would buy it as like a casual snack, but it's definitely not repulsive.
My eyes are literally watering. That was potent. what is this? What am I eating? A brain?
So this one.
Hold on, let me show. I can show the camera.
It's a tumor.
This one looks like a brain.
It's a burnt French. Peanuts. Plate. So these are just like fresh peanuts with a
burnt fresh peanuts.
French peanuts. Oh, sorry,
it's like burnt fresh. Like burnt them just half an hour ago. All right, so it's a peanut.
It's a good peanut.
You have allergies?
Not peanuts.
I'm gonna find out now.
Hey, I texted him well before this, so he if he had forgotten, then it's on him, not me.
Have Jack, I can't do.
It's not easy to chew, though, is it?
No, not at all.
Tasty though.
So French, not bad. You win.
Burnt French peanut is so far the winner.
So these were actually my favorite. They're Boston baked beans. So they're a peanut in a savory shell.
Baked beans.
Okay.
Will it make you fart?
No.
Okay.
Not that my wife has sold me at least.
I expected that to be harder.
Yeah, they're soft.
Yeah.
And they actually taste really good. Like there's a sweetness to them, but also like a slight, like savory notion to it. But
I'm
like,
trying to think what it tastes like. It tastes like something I've had before.
I like it. It's like a. It's almost like a peanut M&M.
Yeah, but softer. That's what I said. I expected it to be harder when I ate it. Like I expected it to be crunchy.
Good shot.
It's not.
And then this last one is the
I can't eat that.
Benny Q Mango Extreme. So it's a mango lollipop. It has three different like sections that I didn't see when I did the video originally, but it is basically salt and chili powder on the outside.
Tom's big bite. Just gotta take a big
bite
out of that.
When they make it, the place is so dusty that the actual stick gets coated in the stuff, so it gets everywhere. So
we mentioned that Tom was okay over there. Tom was motion sick earlier. Don't die.
No, I'm really gonna regret this.
No, you're not. It's gonna be great. So,
are you sure I can eat this?
Yeah.
Yes, it is edible.
I meant more so like not that it was edible. That like it looks like it's hard to get a hold of. I didn't want to ruin it.
Oh no,
you've had one, right?
Yeah. No, there was a box of them at the store I bought.
Okay. Tom, just eat the fucking thing.
Well, I don't know how to open it. Can you open it for me?
Wait. Hit the mic. There you go.
So the funny
I don't
thing
like
is,
that you open that so fast.
The fucking thing, Tom.
So the funny thing is the actual lollipop is in the shape of the mango guy, so you can see eyeballs on it.
Oh, shit.
I'll eat it.
No, you
I'll
sure?
Eat it. Yeah.
I.
Yeah.
How about you take a bite and I'll take a bite?
I can't bite it.
Well, I'm not going to suck it after you've sucked
it.
It
tastes like cardboard.
You were supposed to bite it.
I can't.
It's a hard candy.
Yeah.
Well, get better teeth. Your baby teeth have to fall out at some point.
Oh, God, it tastes like cardboard.
Well, no, that's your
oh, God, I'm going to throw up.
All the way down.
Suck it.
All the way Suck down. It. Keep doing it.
Dude, I seriously might throw up.
Yay! First vomit on a podcast.
Ready? Nope. Nope.
Oh, wow.
Mm-mm.
All right. You don't have to worry
Mm-mm.
about it then.
Mm-mm.
I'm glad I didn't have to do
God,
that.
You can taste some of the stick.
That's what the fucking candy tastes like. It tastes like it's like wood and cardboard. Like.
Judging from your reaction, I think
God,
I'm happy
gross.
To give that a pass.
So the powder on the outside, if you can get past that, my wife assures me that it tastes like a candied mango. But I don't like mango in the beginning.
I like mango, see.
I do, but I don't. Oh God, that's.
Like, I don't understand how mango and chili work together in any so size,
they don't.
Shape, or form.
And that's the beauty of
oh my God.
Candy from Mexico is that they put chili on chili
they have
powder
no
on
safety.
Everything. So like the other one I did was watermelon flavor.
Watermelon and chili?
Yes, it was the same candy coating or the same powder coating, but with over watermelon.
I guess they're just used to it.
Yeah.
It's, I think that the culture is based around the last spices, and this is just me like projecting like how I see all their candy. I grew up in Las Vegas. All that candy was very apparent to me. Like, this is all the stuff I grew up on, not like consuming it, just friends doing it. So there's actually the same powder as this. They have like in a jelly form. Whoa. That you squeeze out of like a pencil shape.
Hmm.
And like people love it. Like people just eat the stuff out of it.
I'm so literally crying right now. That was gross. Like my gag reflex when I was not. Yeah,
I tried two of those.
How? I can't even get like, I couldn't even lick it. Like I couldn't get past the first. Oh my God. Mexico, you have weird candy. At least this, whatever
the, I quite like called some of the other Benny stuff. It was all right. I didn't. The licorice was better than I expected
Benny
it to
K
be.
Mango Extreme. Yeah, licorice. Not the licorice. What was the second? The bean. The bean was probably the best.
There's another one if you want it.
I will.
Okay.
The bean was.
Do you want it?
No, I hate them.
You don't like them?
No, it tastes better. Ooh, if it was.
I don't even like them.
You want this?
Definitely don't want that.
God.
I would have.
Did you seriously?
If you
didn't
slobber all over.
Yeah, I did two of them. Just watch the video.
On video?
Yeah.
Just the video up.
Yeah.
Like right now.
Yeah.
We can link to it.
It'll be up. It'll be up last week. Well.
Can we link to
it? From last week. We can link to it. We have the ability. We can either put the link down. We'll put the link down.
You're doing post on this,
in the
right?
Bot, in the botch. In the box. It's going to say in the crotch box.
Also, if you if you're listening to us.
Up here in the corner.
If you're listening to us, like Degrado does. Hi, Degrado.
Hey, Degrado.
Oh, God. Then you wouldn't have got to see some of the visual representations of candy there. So do remember we have a video form of this podcast as well. So if you want to actually see the candy and see Keegan almost vomit, then you can watch the video. As well.
You can watch it in full. We'll have the full form and I'll probably make this a part.
We should explain the video thing real quick. So can I explain it? Do you mind?
Go.
Because you look, you don't look so good. So
that was gross.
People have been a little confused about it. So you have one full vidcast, which is basically like an hour long or whatever, and that's the whole show, everything that we did, the whole thing. But for YouTube, as a sort of a special YouTube thing, we also break down the sections into like our beginning section where we talk about, you know, what we've been doing, etc. The question section, or bonus level as it's now known, and also just ending stuff like what you're doing later, but
or
also
candy. We might do a special thing at the end. We might
just make
not this
make you test more.
Dude, we're not doing
more
candy.
Weird things, sure.
No, we'll have something at the end.
We need to have you.
We have a go-to guy for weird candy, so
I'll be on his show at some point. I'm gonna. You better have a puke bucket ready. I have a real bad gag reflex. I forgot to tell you guys that.
Wow.
That makes it better.
There you go.
No.
Because I have...
Dude, that seriously, like, it's still in my mouth, and it just, like...
Because I have four different flavored, expired ramen flavors coming in.
Oh, God.
One of them...
Why would you buy them expired?
Because it makes it better.
How?
So, they're rare flavors that came out over a year ago.
Okay.
One that I'm super excited for is corn portage. It's like corn stew. Yeah.
Oh God.
And so
expired corn stew.
Yeah, in a soft
bean
drink
drizzled
form.
That sounds better than that.
In a soft drink, you have to drink it.
Yeah, it's a soda. It's the, you know, the ramen, like the marble drinks you get from the Asian markets.
No, not at all.
Yep.
That's gross.
That's they do. I'm still trying to find a eel soda. It's basically. grilled eel in a soda.
Tom.
Is it actually in there in the bottle?
It's the...
Like tequila worms?
It's the eel juice.
Not so much that. It's basically like cooked down and then added to soft drink. So it's like a gel. So it's black.
So Tom, we're never doing that.
We're probably never doing that. But...
you can check out Dream Saga.
Yeah, let's talk about that. So if you dig the idea... That's true. My wife did make that. If you dig the idea of weird candies and getting a little rundown on where they're from, what they taste like, and then I'm assuming you eat them.
Oh, yeah.
Right.
Make weird faces.
Or just in general, the Dream Saga, the vlogs and things like that. Where do they have to go to?
YouTube.com/TheDreamSagaStudio.
The Dream Saga Studio. And they can check out Cody and all of his wonderful, weird, and bizarre things there.
I can't. That was gross. Like I went into this like, cool, let's try some. That was
so. I have
that one was bad.
I have actually silenced Keegan.
Yeah. You silenced Keegan. We find out a way to shut Keegan the hell up, and that is
chili powder.
whatever the hell this thing is.
Lick the stick. Lick the stick.
So gross.
Tom, lick the stick.
Just lick it.
Yes,
just
lick it. Dude.
It's fine. You guys have shared things before.
See?
Yeah, this is like wood shavings. Yeah. I'm not a big fan of that.
Yep.
Yeah. Yeah. Maybe next time bring something a little different.
I just want really nice.
It was fun though. It was fun to try that. Oh, thank you for sharing this with us.
Fun.
All right, guys. So let's wrap it up. I think so. That makes for episode number 3 of the official Level 2 podcast. Are you still with us? You're like staring at me blankly, like in some kind of a weird haze right now.
Yeah. Take him to the hospital.
I'm sweating now. Like, I'm seriously starting to sweat. Like, that got to me. But no.
We may have triggered Keegan's illness.
That's episode 3, great. You can listen to it on iTunes. If you look, as you search, not look, well, you can look, but search Level 2 Podcast, Google Play Level 2 Podcast, SoundCloud, if you do soundcloud.com/, is it Level 2 Gaming?
Probably, I don't even know.
Search Level 2 Podcast on SoundCloud, it's there as well. Or go to level2gamers.com if you want to watch the video of us and see my lovely face when I swallowed that. I just licked it and it just...
I like that we start our weeks off with podcasts now. It's fun for me. I think it's a good time. It's fun that we have guests, too, that we can
Cody's the first official guest.
Friends of ours. Yeah, first guest on the Level 2 podcast. But it also sets a good tone for the week. So
he joked we stole his Vidcast name, by the way, and I said it was your fault.
Vidcast? I'm sorry. Yeah.
You're fine. I stopped doing them, so it's okay.
He had a copy written.
No.
That'd be great.
Did you? You going to sue us?
I'm tired. But then tomorrow you have our review up, which will be Observance,
yes.
I believe.
Yep.
Which is a fun little movie. It's a horror movie. And
Let me pull up my schedule here, and I can tell you what's on Wednesday as well. We actually have a schedule. I know it doesn't look like a lot of time, so we are somewhat efficient.
Wednesday, is it Overcooked?
Yeah.
That quickly?
Yeah, Wednesday's Overcooked.
Okay, Overcooked is appropriate for this episode.
Have you played Overcooked yet?
That's his impression of Overcooked.
Have you played Overcooked?
No.
Dude, it's fun. It's a lot of fun.
It's a lot of fun.
Yeah.
You should come over and play Overcooked sometime. I feel like you would be a great partner for Overcooked.
Okay. He basically turned into Tom the whole Gordon time. Fucking Ramsay while we were playing.
You'd be a great partner for Overcooked.
How'd you guys know I watched screaming at me. Nothing but Kitchen Nightmares on that.
And then Thursday's London Heist, which I think is by far the VR game or experience that kind of surprised both of us.
One of the most blow-your-mind VR experiences. You had a lot of fun. Since you'd played it before, you were having a little bit of a fun time with the gangsters tweaking their nipples and stuff, so that's going to be funny for Thursday.
He was doing that like when he first loaded up the game. He was like, just how right far away. Can I take this? Like,
the guy Cody was there when I played all these for the first time.
Yeah, I was also there when you punched your lamp.
I don't know what you're talking about. There's no video evidence of that. We lost the video, but I actually did. What was the job simulator?
It was, well, it was that whole like section where and Dave were there that was all gone because like that your internet started freaking out.
But I'm trying to think what game I was playing when that happened.
You were playing. It wasn't Job Simulator.
It was either London Heist or Jobs. It might have been London Heist when I went to go look out the car.
Yeah, you were doing something and you were like trying to throw something and it was like
bam.
Yeah, he just punched it as hard as he could and this thing just rocked back and forth and somehow didn't break.
Yeah.
All right.
And then you know what Friday is?
I
do not know because it has question marks. So we'll figure that out.
Yay! Friday surprise.
We were joking when we said there's a surprise.
Yeah. No idea.
Yeah. I have an idea.
Yeah. But I'd like to thank Cody for coming on to the show. Thank you, buddy.
Again, and, on the Dream Saga.
Thank all of you for listening and or watching us. And as always, welcome to the second level.
Bye. That shit was gross.
Yeah.
You know, we started doing the audio podcast, but people wanted it. The downside to it is we can't track where people are listening. So if you are listening to us on iTunes, please leave us a review on the iTunes App Store. Or if you're on Google Play, leave a review there. We'd love to hear what you guys think about it. Hopefully 5 stars. That's 10. You can't do that.